Now you are the engineer, and you have been given this design, and your task is to analyze the channel to determine the flow depth in the channel from start to finish. This is a single channel with a constant geometry and roughness. The only change in the channel is the slope. Water enters the channel through a sluice gate at the top of the channel. At the bottom of the channel, the water is backed up by water ponding behind a dam. The first step is to complete the steady uniform analysis. Start by calculating the critical depth. Since this is a rectangular channel with a base width of 15 feet and a design flow rate of 500 cubic feet per second, then we can calculate the critical depth directly using this formula. I get a critical depth of 3.26 feet. Next, calculate the normal depth for each segment of the channel. The normal depth is found using the iterative approach to Manning's equation. For the mild channel, I get 4.58 feet for the normal depth, and for the normal depth in the steep channel, I get 1.47 feet. It helps to visualize the solution better if you sketch in the normal and critical depth to your design drawing. Completing this step allows us to classify each segment of the channel as mild or steep. The next step is to qualitatively assess the actual channel flow depth. We do this by sketching how we predict the flow will change as it navigates the changes in slope. For example, at the downstream end, just before the dam, the flow depth will have to increase in order to match the ponded water depth behind the dam. This is a gradually varied flow section. Because the flow depth is supercritical and the dam is ponding the water to a depth above the critical depth, then just before the gradually varied flow profile, there will be a hydraulic jump. When the slope transitions from mild to steep, we should expect to see a GVF profile in the mild and steep sections. We assume that the flow will pass through the critical depth at the grade break. Finally, as water enters the channel, the sluice gate has an opening less than the normal depth, so it is possible that there may be a gradually varied flow section followed by a hydraulic jump. For this to happen, the depth of flow in the mild channel cannot be so deep that it buries the jump. We can use the conjugate depth equation to determine if the jump will occur or not. To organize our calculation, it is important to classify each of the GVF profiles. Starting with the GVF just downstream of the sluice gate, we know that it is an M profile because it is in a mild channel. Because the orange transition line is below the critical depth and the normal depth, then we state that it is a zone 3 profile as well. This makes our first GVF profile an M3. Moving downstream, we are still in the mild channel and the depth is decreasing as the velocity begins to increase. A decreasing flow depth is a zone 2 profile, making this an M2. Entering the steep channel, this becomes an S2 for the same reason that we called the last one an M2. Finally, just after the hydraulic jump and just before the dam, we have a flow depth that is above the normal and critical depth. This means this GVF is classified as an S1 profile. Next, it is always helpful to identify all of the unknowns remaining in the channel. For example, just before the S1, we do not know the depth. It just so happens that we can calculate this depth using the hydraulic jump conjugate depth equation. Once that is done, then we can calculate the length of the S1. Since we already know the normal depth in the mild and steep channel sections, we just need to calculate the length of the M2 and S2 directly. Finally, just downstream of the sluice gate, we do not know the depth at the end of the M3. To find this, we use the hydraulic jump conjugate depth formula, using the normal depth and velocity in the mild channel as the downstream input data. By the way, if you calculate the upstream depth here and find that it is greater than the critical depth, then there will be no hydraulic jump. There will be no M3 because the normal depth in the channel will be so great that it will bury the jump. However, if there is a jump, then the last unknown is the length of the M3. With the channel flow assessed and the unknowns identified, you are ready to start your calculations.